Hi, I'm Bill Kristol. Welcome to Conversations. I'm very pleased to be joined again today by Ron Brownstein. We've had two of these, I believe, in June 2017 and June 2018. Everything you said was correct. And now we're meeting post-election to discuss what happened in November 2018.
We can keep doing it till we get it right.
That would be endless. But no, but we're approximating.
Yes, exactly.
We're getting there. No, I think people should watch those. Those do stand up very well. But let's not go back, and let's just, if someone came down from Mars, I mean, or if a V.O. Key or some wonderful former student of American politics were resurrected, and he said, "What's going on, Ron? What is the current state of American electoral politics?"
Well, look, as we talked about in those earlier sessions, I believe we are living through an overlapping demographic and geographic sorting out of the country, and that all of those trends have really acquired more topspin under Trump, meaning that they are accelerating. What we saw in the 2018 election was a confirmation and really an intensification of the division and the reconfiguring of American politics that was very evident in 2016, both demographically in terms of the divide by age, younger people moving more Democratic, Republicans still very solid among older, although some chinks in that armor this time. Second, the wider divides between college and non-college whites as the price of Trump's effort to generate these enormous margins among working class, older, blue collar, evangelical white voters is a backlash on among college educated white voters, especially women. And then this incredible, I think, and maybe the most striking of all, geographic divide, where Metro America, pretty much everywhere, probably worth talking more about this, Metro America pretty much everywhere made as emphatic a statement of rejection of Trump, I think, as you could have imagined, in terms of the number of House seats Republicans lost in major metro areas, not only in traditionally Democratic areas, but in places that have been much more Republican. And conversely, you know, rural, small town, exurban America, still pretty much on the bus. So the gap between them gets wider.
Yeah, you had said before the election, I think, that you thought the trench between the two Americas might well get even deeper and wider than it has been. And it's been building for a while. I mean, when historians, I don't want to go too much into the past, but when did this begin? I mean, this goes back decades.
Well, it's really the last 25 years of American politics. I mean, certainly since the 70s, we've seen American politics divide more along lines of culture than class. And that is what produces the geographic separation. But having said that, I mean, Bill Clinton in the 1990s was about transcending those cultural divides, a lot of the whole new Democratic agenda. And when he won for president each time, I don't know if we've talked about this before, he won about half the counties in America each time. By the time Obama won re-election, he won only a quarter of the counties in America, but he won 88 of the 100 largest. Hillary Clinton, you know, 4 years after that, she wins less than 500 counties, but wins the 100 largest counties by over 15 million votes. So you see this kind of, the Democratic coalition narrows, but deepens, and then the Republicans kind of control what's outside of it. What happened this time was the Democratic territory expanded out a little further, right? Because not only, so if you look, take Texas.
Just on the history for 1 minute, the footnote. So I guess you could argue, for all that Clinton was such a fascinating figure, in a way he's an interruption or a hiccup in something that begins, I guess, with Nixon, almost the reversal of the working class, and then the, you know, the liberal elite.
Yeah, what I call the class inversion, right? I mean, the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, certainly, we don't have data in the 40s, but I'm sure it's true in the 40s. Democrats run better every election in the presidential with non-college whites than they do with college whites. They were the party of people who work with their hands. And then in the 60s, you begin to see the flip where
silent majority,
racially tinged issues, crime, national strength, defense, Watergate, Vietnam, all of these things. Republicans improve their position among working class whites. You get to the Reagan Democrats and 84 millions of people who grew up in a household with a picture of Walter Reuther on the mantle, Franklin Roosevelt, they find themselves voting Republican. And then the reverse happens in the 80s and 90s, which is Democrats begin to improve their performance among the college educated white voters. All of these trends, you know, Trump takes and magnifies. I mean, he doubles down, explicitly crafts a strategy that is about maximizing the Republican advantage among the groups that are the most uneasy, I think, with both economic and demographic change. So that's older, blue-collar, evangelical, non-urban whites. And
I mean, I suppose people will look back and say Clinton was this parenthesis, but Bush and Obama, both
Obama
knowingly and
yes.
unknowingly, you might just say, or just by who they were,
I mean, Obama
intensify these trends somewhat, right?
Oh, yes,
and then Trump
absolutely.
Sort of puts a real.
Right. Obama, I think, intensifies. I mean, Bush, yes, Bush becomes a much more of a base president as he governed than he ran. 2000, he's a compassionate conservative. 2004, he's promoting ballot initiatives to ban gay marriage.
Right.
So he's kind of heading in this direction. And then Obama in 2008, I remember having a conversation with his advisors. He had been an organizer in steel mills in the back of the yards in Chicago, and they thought he was going to be a candidate who could appeal to white working class voters. Very limited inroads on that. And very limited. But as he governed, they were hoping that the Affordable Care Act, in an irony, eventually maybe it got there, the Affordable Care Act would be something that would be a calling card to working class whites to basically say government doesn't only exist to take your money and give it to poor people, which is what obviously, the kind of the caricature that many have bought into, it can do something for you. They didn't see it that way. The white working class overwhelmingly saw, particularly early on, the ACA as a transfer program. And so that was a big headwind. And then culturally, right, as the presidency went on, he more and more kind of bent to the reality of the new Democratic coalition, which is kind of culturally changing America. Yeah, so he, and by 2012, he basically runs for re-election the same way Bush does in 04, as a kind of a base first. What Bush decided, what Karl Rove and Matthew Dowd and other people decided for Bush in 04 was that, and this was, I think, a seminal moment in American politics, that it was more cost effective to turn out somebody who agrees with you and doesn't usually vote than it was to persuade someone who usually votes but may not agree with you. And Obama did the same thing in 2012. And then Trump has taken that much further as president, where the entire strategy is about energizing what is roughly, on a good day, 45 or 46% of the country.
Yeah, so let's put some numbers on this. So we have this election. The two Americas both show up.
Right.
They show up in large numbers.
Amazing. Raising 115, 116 million people vote, almost 35 million more people than voted in the last midterm, the highest turnout since, I believe, 1914 in a midterm election. And it produces, I think, a very sharp divide, but a very decisive overall result. First of all, the Republicans are closing in, as we're talking, on possibly losing 40 seats in the House, the most seats they have lost since Watergate in any congressional election, presidential or off year. The Democratic margin in the popular vote is past 8, closing in on 9, may exceed 9 million.
So 8-9%.
Yeah, more than the 2010 Tea Party election, potentially more than the 1994, landslide.
And the Republicans, if I'm not mistaken, won narrowly by a percentage point, I think, the national House popular vote in 2016.
Yeah, I don't remember the exact, but it was narrow.
They ran ahead of Trump.
Yeah, it's
actually,
a big, it's
so
a
that's
big.
A big, so you have a, just in the House vote to House vote, apples to apples,
absolutely,
sort of 8-10% switch.
And then to me, what was the most, I think, striking about this election, beside the magnitude, was the nationalization of the trends we're talking about. So if you look in the national polls, a few things happened. First, we had the widest gap we have seen between college and non-college whites and how they have voted in an exit poll, where Democrats still stuck at 37-38% among non-college whites, although there's one exception I'll get to, but getting to 53% among college-educated whites, which we had not seen before. And that gap was true everywhere. Again, with a somewhat of an exception in these upper Midwest states, I'll come back to. We saw a big backlash against Trump among young voters, not only 18 to 29, but 30 to 44. So not only the millennials, younger millennials, but the older millennials and the youngest Gen X. Democrats win 2/3 of 18 to 29 and almost 60% of 30 to 44. And again, it's incredibly consistent. They won 18 to 29 in every state with an exit poll, except for Indiana, where they tied. I mean, every single one. And they won 30 to 44 in almost every state. And
the gap's pretty big, as I recall. So if you put together the 18 to 29 and 30 to 44, so let's say 18 to 44.
It's a big
that's
number.
That's about 60-40, better than 60-40 Democrat.
Yes,
Democratic,
definitely. Yeah. 60, it was 2/3 and 3/5.
So
yes. 62-3. Right, probably in that range.
And then among 45 and up, it's about 50-50.
Right, because Republicans underperformed where they have been among seniors. And that may have been the Democratic campaign on the Affordable Care Act and also arguing that the tax cut would eventually force them to go after Medicare. But I was going to say, so like if you look at these kind of contrasts, on the exit polls, they're everywhere. But the actual results really is what is what's striking. Because, you know, we talked about, you know, the heart of the vulnerability for Republicans were the last Republican House members holding on in otherwise blue metro areas. They were the equivalent in 2018 of the John Spratts and Ike Skeltons of 2010. All those rural blue dog Democrats.
94 Southern Democrats.
Yeah, these members of the House who have been holding on for years in places that have been going the other way at the presidential level, the other way culturally. But, you know, it's not a it's not Nancy Pelosi, it's old Ike, you know, or old John or John Murtha. 2010, the lease ran out for all of those rural Democrats. The blue dogs were kind of almost exterminated, and they've never really come back in those places. I think the safest prediction we talked about was that that was going to happen to a lot of Republicans in the suburbs of Philadelphia, suburbs of Minneapolis, suburbs of Chicago, New Jersey, Denver, all of those places.
Northern Virginia.
Okay, all of those places, in fact, on election night, they went down. But there was another concentric circle of Republicans in districts that were demographically similar, but had very different political traditions, that were in more, that had been in more Republican in their leaning. So you're talking about Richmond, Charleston, Atlanta, Houston, Dallas, Kansas City, you know, places like that, where there, Oklahoma City, where the overall metro was not, had not been nearly as blue. Well, many of those lost as well. And obviously the biggest example is right here in Orange County, California, where, you know, kind of the seedbed of modern conservatism with Nixon and Reagan, and Republicans were swept out of every seat that they hold in Orange County. So to me, the most striking thing of all the results was how uniformly the white collar suburbs that had normally voted Republican on economic issues rejected the Trump stamp on the party. And conversely, beyond that, in kind of exurban and small town America, yeah, there were a few dents in the fortress, Abby Finkenauer in Iowa, a couple seats in upstate New York, some heavily Hispanic but rural seats in the central, but not much. I mean, Republicans, that pretty much held very solid for Trump. Their numbers among non-college whites were over 60% again for Republicans overall. So what you see, I think, is this alignment, very clear, and understanding that midterms don't predict the outcome of the presidential 2 years later, when we can talk about that. But I think the parameters of the presidential are pretty clear, that you see a consolidation of the metro areas pretty much everywhere against kind of non-metro pretty much everywhere. I mean, look at Texas. I mean, Beto O'Rourke won the five biggest metropolitan counties in Texas as a Democrat by 800,000 votes. Barack Obama won those same five counties in 2012 by a combined roughly 80,000 votes. He won them by 10 times
so
as much.
With Obama, it was he won the cities and then he lost the suburbs. A few states,
and he won the cities
or
narrowly,
whatever, and so washed out, and then he gets clobbered out.
Yeah, he gets clobbered, and that's, and of course that is what happened to Beto too. In the end, that you
well,
know,
he only lost by what 2-3 points,
right? You know, the rural small town, but if you look at the results in statewide elections, there, first of all, there were, as we talked about a minute ago, there are only 13, Trump only won 13 of the 100 largest counties in America. 87 of the 100 voted against him. Of those 13, I looked at this, roughly half moved sharply toward the Democrats. The largest, in 2018, the largest county he won in America was Maricopa.
Trump in 2016.
In 2016. Yeah. That was Maricopa, which is Phoenix and its suburbs, was the largest. And again, it's indicative of these places that are demographically similar to the suburbs of Philly, perhaps, although more retirees, but had not, didn't have that Democrat tradition. This time, Kristen Sinema won Maricopa County by 60,000 votes. The second largest county in America that Trump won was Tarrant County, which is Fort Worth. Beto won Tarrant County. Suffolk County was the third largest. They had kind of a mixed result where Lee Zeldin held on, but it voted strongly for Gillibrand. And then you go through the list, you know, Macomb County in Michigan, of the 13 counties in the top 100 that Trump won, literally half of them voted solidly Democratic in this election. It's so we see the nationalization of this kind of metro that is diverse, younger, more secular, and more information age, really recoiling from Trump's vision of what the country is. And then, you know, what we can call Trump country, You know, not, you know, maybe a few objections here and there, but not many. And mostly, and that allows you to win North Dakota, and that allows you to win Missouri, and it allows you to win Indiana in the Senate. But it's an open question whether it allows you to get 270 electoral college votes because of the one big exception, which we probably have to get to, which is that the three blue wall states in the upper Midwest, Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania, that Trump dislodged from the blue wall that made him president, they showed clear signs of reverting to kind of their pre-Trumpian behavior.
So, I mean, in a sense, one might say that the suburbs of Phoenix and Houston are now more like the suburbs of Philadelphia and Chicago than they're like the rest of the state that they're in.
That is the key point. And I think Kristen Soltis Anderson wrote that in one of the conservative publications. That is exactly right. That is the key. That is what has happened under Trump, which is that, you know, we had seen these white collar suburbs moving Democratic since the 90s. And certainly, you know, and I believe that if you look at the states that flip from red to blue, in the 90s, it was California, New Jersey, and Illinois. In the 2000s, it was essentially Virginia, Colorado, and to a somewhat mixed extent, North Carolina. And in this decade, it's potentially Georgia, Arizona, and Texas, not being as blue as the first. But as they go in a Democratic direction, two things happen. The minority population grows, in all the cases, the minority population grows, and the white-collar suburbs become more competitive for Democrats. And historically, what kept Arizona and Georgia and Texas from joining Colorado and Virginia, much less New Jersey, California, and Illinois, was that those white-collar suburbs had not flipped. You know, they're more socially conservative, more of them are evangelicals, it's all still true. But in this election, you know, Kyrsten Sinema wins college-educated whites, and Beto O'Rourke gets into the mid-40s. We talked about that the last time we were together. Democrats have been stuck around 30% of college whites in Texas. He gets into the mid-40s. If you're in the mid-40s, like what he got this time, and you project forward to the youth and minority turnout of a presidential year, you don't have to improve a heck of a lot to win Texas.
And say a word about the states that have gone in the other direction, because that's also interesting. Yes. Ohio and, if I'm not mistaken, Ohio and Iowa were absolutely on the bubble in 2000 and 2004. Wasn't Iowa resolved by a few thousand votes
and
in each
Ohio
of those?
Historically,
and Ohio is famously the late state to be called in 2004. Yeah. They've become redder.
Yes, they have.
And why are they different from?
Because, I mean, it's the demography, right? So these are states that are older and more blue-collar whites. And more white Christians.
Less well-educated, more evangelical.
More evangelical or
older.
Even older, where Democrats have been kind of levitating above their national performance, was the phrase I used in 2016. The levitation ran out. And you'd have to look at this election.
Missouri was once a semi-swing state.
It was. But Bill Clinton won it both times,
yes,
I'm pretty sure.
That's right, yeah.
And certainly, you know, I covered Claire McCaskill's earlier races there. It was a swing state, and Democrats could win. But the both sides are moving, right? Small town, mid-sized city, rural America, blue-collar America is doubling down on the Republican. And Trump has consciously focused on expanding that advantage. I think the advantages of that were clear in 2016 when he won, and he also helped hold the Senate seats in Ohio, Pennsylvania, and Wisconsin that were on the ballot. This election, the price of that trade became more apparent, where you see the movement of the urban centers and the metro areas and younger voters everywhere. I mean, everywhere. I mean, you're talking about in 2020, millennials will exceed the baby boom as a share of eligible voters, not of actual voters, but they will exceed the share of eligible voters. Post-millennials will first come into the electorate. By 2024, post-millennials and millennials have to be pretty close to the same share of actual voters as baby boomers. Okay, you're talking about 67% voting Democratic. I mean, that is not a long-term kind of growth strategy. And yes, if you can certainly, in the Electoral College and the Senate, given the kind of the way, you know, power is distributed, you can squeeze out another win in 2020, maybe even in 2024. But it gets harder and harder as this kind of emerging diverse America moves into the electorate to, in effect, base your strategy on saying, you know, on mobilizing other people by saying we're going to stop them from taking political power, economic power. I mean, they got it. That to me is like the thing. The thing is, like, the people who are targeted by Trump, who Trump uses as foils to maximize his numbers among his base, they got the joke. I mean, they came out, they felt that their place in America was being threatened, and they came out and they voted.
demography is destiny. It seems increasingly, as you say, we're not persuading. We're having sort of, you know, elections that look more like censuses than elections that look more, more like arguments. Or maybe that's your formulation.
No, no,
or
someone said that. Somebody said that, yes. And that's right at this point. But, you know,
now,
not,
what
entirely, by the way.
So, what is turning out these voters on both sides? Do we know from this election any more than we did before?
I mean, I think, look, first of all, there are still swing voters. And, you know, there are swing voters. There are white upper middle class in particular. I mean, independents, you know, broke. There are some independents. They broke for Democrats. You know, a lot of these white-collar white voters who we talk about moving away from Trump, they don't show up in polls as Republicans because they're, you know, center-right independents who normally vote Republican. And there's no question, you know, people can say, well, you know, how accurate are the exit polls or whatever. You know, whatever you think about the exit polls, the fact is there were an awful lot of white-collar suburbs that Republicans won in the past that they lost. And something had to happen. You know, it was not all differential turnout, I think. There were voters who have normally been comfortable voting Republican, who were not comfortable voting Republican because they felt that they were not going to constrain Trump or restrain him in any way. And I think what has to be a little ominous for Republicans is that they lost 40 seats with unemployment at 4%, and they had the biggest losses in the places that are doing the best.
Which suggests a cultural vote, not an economic vote.
It says a cultural vote. A statement about, I think, you know, Trump ran the last, look, he is throughout his presidency, but even more in the last 2 weeks, it was as if George Wallace was broadcasting from the White House. I mean, the things he was saying, kind of the open appeals to racial resentment and racial fears and the caravan, you know, is coming to get you. People heard that. Okay, and much like Ed Gillespie in Virginia when he, you know, kind of broadcast MS-13 every day, it was not only Hispanics who found that threatening to their vision of what America is. And what Trump is doing is forcing, well, he's not creating it, obviously, because we've been talking about going on for decades, but he is hardening this sort of cultural sorting of the electorate in a way that is seeding the places that are doing the best in the economy, that are growing, that are the most diverse, that are the most economically productive. I don't know if you saw the data that Brookings pulled together.
Summarize that. That's interesting.
I believe that the divide we have is between, the fundamental divide in our politics is between those who are comfortable with the way America is changing and those who are not. And that goes
the coalition of
transformation and the coalition of restoration. And that goes beyond, I mean, the most obvious manifestation of that is culture and demographics, role of women, increasing number of minorities, contribution of immigrants to society, but it's also economic. And that the places that are at the forward edge of economic change tend to be part of the coalition of transformation. And what Brookings calculated was that the seats, the House seats represented by Democrats in the new Congress will account for over 60% of the total economic output of the country. And the Republican seats will only be about 40%. And that is consistent with the 2016 result where Hillary Clinton's counties, even though there were only less than one-sixth of all the counties in the country, accounted for two-thirds of the GDP. So you basically have the parts of America that are in every way, I think, defining the future, that Trump is systematically alienating Republicans from. And it is, as I said, it is not as if you can't win with the other strategy, particularly given the way the Electoral College works and the Senate works, but it's hard to see how that is a long-term proposition, both because of the demography, but also because I believe in American history, political power follows economic power. And the idea that the places that are the most left behind in the emerging economy are going to indefinitely set the rules for the places that are driving the economic innovation and growth just seems to me inherently implausible. I mean, maybe one manifestation of that was the fundraising.
Yeah.
The big Democratic fundraising advantage, right? I mean, this incredible small donor. I was in several races this year that I visited where you combine kind of urban and non-urban areas. And like, for example, the Washington 8 seat that went from Seattle to the eastern part of the Cascades. The number of people who contributed and volunteered from Seattle to come out and elect the Democrat in a seat the Democrats had never won since 1980, since it was created, was enormous. I mean, like I said,– the people who Trump has targeted got the message.
Yeah, interesting. I mean, and I guess in just in pure numbers, someone from abroad was asking me about this, and it occurred to me that I think Democrats now control, well, got about 53% of the vote, 54% of the vote, it looks like, for the House. About the same number for the Senate.
Yeah.
Their seats are bigger than the Republican seats, if you actually add up.
And you got the California thing where you got both two Democrats.
Yeah, so that's a little confusing. But I think Democratic governors are now going to govern about 54% of the country, even though they have a couple fewer than the Republicans. So the actual sort of just pure split in the country in numbers, leaving aside the Electoral College for a minute, does feel like it's a little bit...
I believe the
Democrats have a bigger coalition.
The coalition of transformation is bigger than the coalition of restoration. I think the evidence is, there's a lot of different ways you can measure that. But that doesn't mean it can govern, right? Both because, one, they don't turn out, pieces of it do not turn out as much as the Republican coalition. Although, having said that, the shift of white-collar whites, who are the most dependable voters of all, kind of changes that equation a little bit. You know, Republicans are heavily reliant now on non-college whites, and they don't vote in midterms as much as the college whites do. So the assumption has been correctly that midterm electorates are more favorable to Republicans. It becomes less true when the white upper middle class realigns. But first, so there's turnout issues, there's distribution issues. I mean, clearly Democrats are overly concentrated in big cities, which is a problem in kind of legislative arenas. The Senate, the two senators per state rule really is a big advantage for Republicans at this point because, you know, the smaller states lean, not all, I mean, you got New England and Oregon, but they basically lean toward those interior, mostly white, heavily rural Christian states where Republicans are going to do very well. The Electoral College, we had three cases in our first 210 years where they diverged from the popular vote. Now we've had two in five elections, and it's not coincidental. They both went to the Republicans. That could happen repeatedly. And then there's all the other issues about kind of voter ID laws and, you know, whether the red states are making it too hard to vote. And registering voters in Texas is, you know, extremely difficult. They make it a lot of hurdles. So all of those things mean that the coalition transformation, even if it is bigger, isn't guaranteed to govern. But having said that, again, you know, millennials will exceed baby boomers as a share of eligible voters in 2020. Millennials and post-millennials will significantly exceed baby boomers as a share of eligible voters by 2024. And don't get me started on 2028. Eventually, the bill comes due.
Right.
Eventually, the bill comes due. If you are essentially saying we are writing off the generations entering the electorate because we're going to use them, in essence, as a foil to maximize our advantage among the pieces of the electorate that are shrinking, yeah, I almost would ask you a question. I am stunned how little, other than this piece by Kristen that I mentioned, how little debate and discussion there has been among Republicans about the extent of their suburban wipeout in this election. Not only in, as I say, not only in the normally Democratic places, but in the places that have been much more Republican. There are very few, I see very few voices either elected or from the, you know, strategic community getting up and saying, look at the direction we're heading here.
Unless you're an anti-Trump Republican.
Yeah.
Which you say, in case you say it, but then people say, well, you just don't like Trump.
But why are
I said the more sophisticated argument, I suppose, from the Trump rationalizing or Trump accepting Republicans would be, look, this was an off-year election. They want to check the president.
Yes.
Voters in the Richmond suburbs voted for a Democrat over a Republican because on the margin, or she won by a point or whatever, because they thought, you know, it's not good to have the one party controlling all three branches, especially with Trump, who's a little erratic and overreaches, so let's have the Democrats run the House. That doesn't necessarily tell you how they vote in a straight-up choice for presidency. It doesn't tell you how they vote if they're reassured that the checking is happening and therefore they can kind of go back to a more, you know, I mean, I guess that would be the argument.
And there's some truth to that, right? It's not an unreasonable argument, but I think, you know, to ignore, basically, if you were doing a science experiment and you were asking what groups would recoil from other Republicans if faced with a Trump-like appeal and presidency, exactly what you would have predicted on the chalkboard happened.
Right.
And so to then turn around and say, well, it's no big deal.
And the economy being so strong, I think, is a big problem for the
4% unemployment, lose 40 seats. How do you do that?
Yeah. As we were discussing before we began the conversation off air, you know, in the past, these off-year elections, the economy was slowly recovering in 94, 2010,
yes,
from recessions
Reagan,
in both
82.
Cases. Reagan, 82, in the recession still. And then the incumbent president did better because the economy really came back right. in the next 2 years.
Right.
Presumably the economy's not going to get better in the next 2 years. So,
and if anything, you think there's only downside. And the again, the people who are doing the best are the ones who pull back the most.
Yeah. I mean, I think the turnout argument also is interesting. It cuts a little bit against my mythical, fairly pro-Trump Republican explaining that, well, it's just checking. Because you got mobilization on both sides,
yes.
right? It wasn't that the
right.
Republicans were demoralized, which
no.
the typical midterm
right.
can be reversed because
2010.
The electorate is so different in
right.
a presidential year. I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but it would seem like if this electorate is a more presidential type electorate, both in absolute numbers and in distribution, it's a better predictor of a presidential election,
yes.
right?
I mean, and if anything, the one, even with the higher turnout among young people, the one glaring thing about the midterm is that youth turnout as a share of the vote was lower than it will be in 2020. So the one, the biggest, yeah. and it may be that the blue collar white share will be a little higher than it was, but I think the biggest change between the electorate in 2018 and 2020 is that more of the, a bigger share of the electorate in 2020 will be under 44. And that's where Trump is struggling the most. I mean, that's the one thing that even with, again, they turned out in bigger, much bigger numbers than we've seen before. They held their share of the vote even as the total pie got a lot bigger. But it's like 9-10%. It's probably going to be like more like 14% for under 30 in 2020. And again, that is the piece of the electorate that he is most conspicuously alienating, even as he drives away all these white collar whites. Again, once you have once Republicans can no longer count on most white collar whites, the composition of the electorate stuff doesn't benefit them as much, right? Because yeah. I mean, they are reliable voters in the midterm.
I mean, of course, events could happen and things could change, and we'll just stipulate
sure,
that
right.
no one's being deterministic.
And it's happened. Look, I mean, if you go back, right? We talked about this: 1958, 1966, 1974, 1978. 2006, I might be missing one. All those cases, bad midterm for the president's party. 2 years later, the White House changes hands. On the other hand, 1954, bad for Eisenhower, but he wins. Reagan, 82, turns around and wins. Clinton, 94, turns around and wins. Obama, 2010, turns around and wins. There's not a decisive
right.
pattern about whether the midterm predicts. I mean, look at 38, the worst ever,
right.
one of the worst ever for Roosevelt, and then he wins. In 2 years later. So Truman in 46, he loses bad and he wins 2 years later.
Right.
So there's lots of examples of presidents coming back. I don't think you can look at this and say Trump is doomed, but I think what you can say is that we have the concrete is hardening. I mean, the molds are hardening. We know, I think, an awful lot about what this will look like demographically and geographically. People are responding, as I said, if you had a science experiment, people on both sides are responding the way you would predict to the kind of presidency that he is offering. And what that sets up is it's just absolute battle of the bulge, as I like to say, in 2020, between what America has been and what it is becoming.
I suppose that happens because it is an intensification of trends that were already in place. If it was a one-off, you might say, well, it wouldn't be hardening. It would
yes.
be kind of a reaction,
yeah,
but
right.
then people would go back to something else.
Right.
But the fact that he's compounding something that's already a trend that's already begun.
That's absolutely right.
And it's been underway for quite a while, right?
Right, that's absolutely
and
right.
Cultural
I mean,
developments that
the
are underway.
Yeah, I mean, the culture supplanting class as the principal divide, I think, is something that goes back really to the 60s, to the 68 election probably is the beginning. But the specific kind of configuration that we're living through is really since the 90s, I think. And we're just seeing it, again, kind of hit the ground with topspin. Under Trump, it's just moving faster, and you get the nationalization. I mean, I don't think people have really kind of fully, as I say, in the Republican Party, kind of grapple with the thought of Maricopa County
yeah.
voting Democratic or the big five urban counties in Texas giving an 800,000 vote margin to a Democrat. I mean, that was not possible 10 years ago, remotely.
And in the case, in the case of Maricopa, which is interesting, they stuck Republican at the gubernatorial
yeah.
level with Ducey. So that suggests a different kind of Republican
yes. yeah.
can still do fine there.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, what is interesting to me is that in the federal race for the Senate, you've had a pretty attractive Republican candidate. Or I think one would have said that Arthur McSally, and not particularly Trumpy,
right,
kind of a class.
And then she went much further in a Trump direction.
Right.
And
also all the federal races just got nationalized because it was
nationalized.
All about, are you going to vote with or against Trump? In the Senate or the House, right?
You know, we've talked about this. I think we have talked about this before. The general trend is that our House races and our Senate races are becoming more parliamentary, where it is becoming harder to win in districts or states that usually vote the other way for president. I mean, they're really about kind of less about individuals, more about which party do you want to be in control, and that question is totally dependent, heavily dependent on your views about the president. In this election, this hit a new peak. I mean, we saw, according to the exit poll, 90% of the people who disapproved of Trump voted Democratic for the House, which is the highest we've had, the highest share of presidential disapprovers who voted for the other party since 1982. And 87% of the people who approved of Trump, 88% of the people who approved of Trump voted Republican. If you look at the Senate races, every Democratic Senate candidate, except for Menendez, Bob Menendez, scandal-tarred Bob Menendez in New Jersey, every other one won at least 88% of Trump disapprovers. And almost all of them were 90 and above. I mean, so we had a very parliamentary, and in fact, if you look at, you know, where do Republicans make gains? They made gains in North Dakota, Missouri, Indiana, and Florida, which are all states that have voted Republican in a majority of the cases since 1992. I think it is now, let's see if I give the numbers here off the top of my head, something like, there are 26 states that have voted Republican in most elections since 92, 24 that have voted Democratic in most elections. Republicans are up to approximately, I think it is 46 of the 52 Senate seats in the 26 states that have voted for them. And Democrats are up to 41 of the 48. I mean, Democrats gained Nevada.
Right.
Now, they gained Arizona on the other side, but they lost four on the other side.
Right.
You know. So you're seeing this kind of, a clarification up and down the ballot, where, in effect, the parties are partitioning the country into these spheres of influence, which have very consistent lines of. Now, the governors are different because they're less, you know, they're less tied to the federal issues. But, you know, it would not be surprising to see Republicans in serious trouble in places like Maine in 2020 or Colorado, you know, places that have voted traditionally Democratic at the presidential level. I mean, Cory Gardner has to be the most endangered, followed closely by Susan Collins.
And the Democratic senators already lost those states in 2014.
There aren't that many left, but there are a few.
There are
six left. I have a hard time naming them all, but there are six Democrats left in states that have voted mostly Republican.
Right.
Now, of course, there's a little advantage for the Republicans because there are slightly more states that vote Republican at the presidential level than Democratic.
Yeah, I mean, it does happen even, as you've been saying, within states. We were saying about Arizona and Texas, but I was struck, and I won't get the numbers quite right, in Governor Walker in Wisconsin, having been elected and reelected and survived recall, so he's won three times statewide, running for a third term, which is always tough, against a very ordinary, bland Democrat. So it's a pretty good sort of case study, maybe. Loses by a point, I think. It ended up being maybe a point and a half, something like that. Having won before by, what, 4, 5, 6 points. Mm. So not a huge swing, but a swing against the Republicans. What was striking was he improved his vote. Did you see these numbers?
Yes.
In rural counties and counties that he carried, and then got lost by a bigger margin in urban and some suburban counties.
And he not only lost in the Democratic-leaning suburbs, but he lost a lot of margin in the Republican-leaning suburbs, right? So it wasn't only that Dane County, Madison, produced astronomical numbers, but what, you know, the wow counties, they call them, around Milwaukee, he underperformed.
Right.
And we saw that in Texas. I mean, like, not only did Beto win the urban centers, Beto O'Rourke against Cruz, but places like Collin County outside of Dallas that used to be 2-1 Republican, Cruz won like 53-47. And there were other suburban counties outside of Houston and Austin that actually flipped, that O'Rourke carried. And again, this is the, I'm just astonished there isn't more conversation in Republican ranks about the extent of the white-collar recoil from so many aspects of Trump. Open appeals to racial resentment, the way he talks about women, the daily uncertainty that any of the constraints on the rule of law will hold. I mean, there is a price that is being paid, and yet you have, you know, Hewitt and, you know, all Peggy Noonan, it's like a slap on the wrist, and it's like everyone is doing their best to minimize what just happened. If this alignment endures, if in fact you have a Republican Party that is overwhelmingly strong among blue-collar, evangelical, non-urban whites, but is losing 2/3 of people under 30, 3/5 of people 30 to 45, and now losing a clear majority of college whites, where they lose, as we talked about, the Democrats had their best number ever among college white women, but also ran almost even among college white men, which is pretty remarkable too. If that's the alignment for the next 15 years, you know, remember during this, you actually remember this. Remember during the SALT talks, during the SALT debates, when the Committee on the Present Danger and your dad, and the Democrats would ask the U.S. generals, "Would you trade our army for their army? Remember our weapons for their weapons?"
Right.
Remember that was kind of the response. Would you trade? Which hand would you want for the next 15 years?
No, I think the Trump. Obviously, I'm against the Trump hand for substantive reasons for the country, but I, as a political and electoral matter, it's hard for me to see how he pulls that off. Now, I'd say the Trump people have short time horizons.
Yeah.
He surprised everyone in 2016. And so that gets to, let's just talk about 2020 in a very concrete way. Let me just back up. On your question of why there isn't more Republican alarm, leaving aside Never Trumpers, some of whom are still Republican, like me, and some of whom aren't. Mm. I would say one thing. I do think the weirdness of the fact that election night looked less devastating than it turned out to be 2 weeks later, now that we're still counting all these votes from California and the whole Orange County swath of suburbs are gone and other places look like they might tip over. That had something to do with it. Trump did a pretty good job on election night of saying, hey, picked up Senate seats, unprecedented. House always goes, who knows if it's 31 or 34 or 37 seats, who can keep track of that, you know?
Right.
And I do think there was a certain amount of Republican complacency as a result. You know, Mitch McConnell is still majority leader. They'll still confirm the judges. The basic outlines of Trump's deregulatory and tax-cutting agenda aren't going to be overturned by a Democratic House. Right. So, you know, off your setback, and then Trump gets to show up again in 2020 and pull off an inside straight. I guess that would be the argument.
Yeah, right.
So can he pull the inside straight again? Let's get to that. You hinted at this before in terms of, I mean, what happened in 2016, to be very simple about it, is he held these states that were teetering and that had been genuine swing states, let's say especially Florida, obviously, and also North Carolina.
Right.
Lost all the other states that were going Democratic and then miraculously pulled the upper Midwest.
Three states out of the blue wall.
Only one of which he needed to win, actually, but he won all three.
Yeah.
Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, and Michigan.
And that is an advantage that he has, that Democrats, you know, so
looking forward.
The first caveat, obviously, we said, is that the midterms do not predict the outcomes. Clearly, that we've seen that repeatedly. But as I said, I think they do give us the parameters. And, you know, the key to Trump winning the presidency was dislodging Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania from, my phrase, the blue wall, which were states that had voted Democratic in all six elections from 92 through 2012.
All six post-Cold War elections.
Yeah,
right.
18 states had voted Democratic in all of those consecutive elections. The most states they had won that often, I believe, ever. He knocked Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania out by a combined 80,000 votes. So what happened, you know, what happened in those states? I think that is the first place where Democrats are looking after the midterm. Democrats elected a senator and a governor in each state, right? And
not by particularly close margins in most cases.
Yeah, Wisconsin was competitive at the governor. The Michigan Senate turned out a little closer than they thought. Pennsylvania looks very tough for Trump. I mean, I think it looks very, based on these results, because what you saw were Democrats not only running up the score in white collar suburbs, but moving back into some of the mid-sized cities that he really improved on, like Erie and Scranton, that have a more blue collar presence. Michigan, again, I think kind of, you'd have to say more of a toss up, but leaning Democratic. And then Wisconsin feels like, to me right now, the absolute tipping point. I should go back a step. If you kind of think about this, the 15, there are none of the states that Clinton won, I think, showed any vulnerability to Trump.
I guess the two she won by the narrowest margins
were Minnesota
and New Hampshire.
Right.
New Hampshire's very small, so let's put that aside.
Right. I mean,
and
I don't think
Minnesota is an older and whiter state.
And it should be, but his approval rating in the exit poll was 45%. He faced high levels of disapproval among college whites and subpar performance among non-college whites in Minnesota. Maybe New Hampshire, there's some opening for him, but you know,
they did badly in New Hampshire. They lost both houses of the legislature,
Governor
Sununu hung on with a reduced margin.
Right, so it's hard to see that. So they start with all that. And then, you know, they really have two pathways back to 270. One is through the Rust Belt, and one is through the Sun Belt. And the Sun Belt are the new opportunities that emerge. Let's file them for 1 second. I think the evidence from 2018 is that, and I've talked to Democrats, I think kind of uniformly, the shortest pathway back to the White House. The clearest road. Woody Hayes in Ohio State used to talk about 3 yards in a cloud of dust. I think it's 3 states in a cloud of dust. I mean, it really is Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania. The states that he dislodged showed clear evidence of second thoughts. And it was, if you look at his approval rating in the exit poll in the states, they're at 47 or below in all 3 states. And to me, what really jumped out was that not only did he face his highest disapproval among college white women in those 3 states as in any battleground. So just to make sure what I'm saying, among college white women, roughly 2/3 in each of those 3 states said they disapproved of Trump. That was the highest in any of the 2020 battlegrounds for which there were exit polls this year. But even more significant, you know, Democrats, I think, were frustrated in most parts of the country that they could not recover more ground among working class white women, that they, they keep thinking, Trump is somehow going to. It didn't happen in most places, but in these places, it did happen.
So that cuts against that's the caveat to the overall
narrative. That is the caveat to the overall narrative. I mean, the Midwest exceptionalism. So in these 3 states, in the exit poll, his disapproval among non-college white women was between 46% and 48%, which is plenty for Democrats to win those states back, because the secret ingredient to him winning all three was his strength. The fact that so many working class white women in the Midwest rejected the first female, major party nominee is, to me, the principal reason he was president. But
a lot of that was about her.
A lot of that was about her. You know, John Brabender, I was talking to, who was a Republican strategist based in Pennsylvania, he was, look, you can't underestimate the Clinton factor with those working class white women. And so
the negative Clinton.
It's
such an irony, the first female nominee. I'm not saying good or bad, just as a factual matter that she was more off-putting to those swing voters and probably therefore lost the election because of those 3 states than a generic
Democrat.
Male would have been.
Right, absolutely. Isn't that amazing? But if you're a Republican, I would have to say that the results, if you're a Trump fan, both the electoral results and the exit poll kind of supplementary data from Michigan, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin is the most ominous thing here. Now, the best news is that Ohio looks really hard for Democrats. Iowa, I think, remains really hard for Democrats. And then you've got the whole question of the Sun Belt.
And before coming to the Sun Belt, assuming Trump could hold those Sun Belt states, which include Florida, which is a very swing state, but still, he's won it. And the Republicans won both governor and Senate races there. The good news from a Trump point of view is he only has to win one of those three.
One of those three.
The Democrats have to sweep them. So that's goes a little wrong in one state.
Right, exactly. The Democrats have to win all three unless they pick up one of the Sun Belt.
So let's talk about those for
a second. Unless they pick up one of the Sun Belt. And there, look, you have...
So what's that, Florida, North Carolina?
Well, first of all, I think we can say that Nevada has moved out of the swing state. It's not completely out of reach for Trump, but it's very hard. He was a 47% approval, big Latino turnout. The Culinary Workers Union has shown it's got a lot of juice. It can really turn out the vote. By the way, unions seem to be the only thing that succeeds at turning out large numbers of Hispanic voters, just parenthetically. Colorado, he's not in the game anymore. Cory Gardner's, I think is dead man walking. And then New Mexico, not really in the game, which was earlier in the century. What's left in the Sun Belt, and Virginia's not in the game. I mean, so those four have moved from kind of purple to pretty seriously blue at the presidential level, at least. So what have you got left? You've got kind of the SEC and the Southwestern Conference. You've got North Carolina, Florida, and Georgia. And then you've got Arizona and Texas, actually, of those, Arizona, I think, looks like the best bet. The Southwest looks, it's interesting because there are contrasting strengths. In the Southeast, you have large African-American populations, and they vote more Democratic than the Hispanic populations do in the Southwest. So that's an advantage. But those working class white numbers in the Southeast are really unbelievable.
So even though Florida, which has been just a dead even state for 2 decades,
10,000 votes out of 8 million in the Senate race. It's hard. I think Florida.
But it was stunning on election night. I was looking at it, and I'm sure you were, it's such an interesting state, and you get familiar with it over these cycles, and looking at, county by county. And I kept thinking, I think Nelson and Gillum, even, I thought, we're going to win, because they're running up these margins in Broward and Dade and Miami-Dade.
And then Orlando
you project,
and Tampa.
And then you project out the way you do when you're looking, if you're not at the precinct level and you see it's 50% in, and you think, well, let's see if that's going to double the margin here. And then the panhandle comes in, and those margins were insane.
Insane. And also in parts of the I-4 corridor in between Orlando and, I mean, he won, the Democrats won most of the places that we think of as the historic swings, especially in the I-4 corridor in the middle of the state from Orlando to Tampa, but Republicans generated just astronomical margins in retiree communities, older whites, and then rural places, small town places. So that's kind of the modern dynamic of politics. And one thing that strikes me is that in Georgia, in North Carolina, in Florida, and in Texas, there are probably enough of those rural, small town places where the elevated margins Trump creates can overcome, probably, not guaranteed, the loss he creates in the urban areas. Arizona's different. Arizona, you know, just there's a lot of rural parts of the state. There aren't that many people. So if you lose, if he loses Maricopa County in Arizona, which is not guaranteed, again, he, you know, might be tougher, he might be stronger than McSally, but I don't think he can overcome it the way he can overcome losing the suburbs of Atlanta or the metro areas in Texas or even in Florida. There isn't enough else. So actually, I kind of felt, came out of this election feeling like Arizona, of the Sun Belt options, right now looks the best for Democrats. I mean, North Carolina is tough. I mean, the Democrats continue. North Carolina, Florida, and Georgia now are all very similar, where the Democrats are really consolidating their strength in the metro areas. They may, in fact, get elevated turnout among African Americans, but there are a lot of rural whites, and they love Trump, you know? And Texas is like that, too. Florida's kind of got the exception where I think a lot of Democrats are kind of scratching their heads over what happened with Hispanic voters and why Gillum and Nelson both underperformed, and that was critical in their defeat. But, you know, the Sun Belt, I've written this many times, I believe the Sun Belt is the long-term future of the Democratic Party, that they're going to have to win more of these Sun Belt states to offset the Missouris and the North Dakotas, et cetera, they're going to be losing. But if you look at the evidence for 2020, right now, the straightest line back to the White House is right through those kind of Rust Belt, metal-bending states of Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania. There's not going to be a Democrat like Hillary Clinton who spends $100 million in Florida or whatever she spends and $100 million in Ohio and minimizes Michigan. I mean, those are going to be the center of the campaign. I think
with Arizona, maybe.
With Arizona.
And Florida, I suppose.
With Arizona, so, Florida. I think they will stay in Florida.
As the possible pickups to compensate for Wisconsin.
I think they stay in Florida, but I would be surprised if they invest in Florida at the same level. If Joe Biden is the nominee, they invest in Ohio. I doubt it's the same level. If Beto is on, the biggest question really, in some ways, is Texas, because you can make a plausible case for competing in Texas that they can get close, but you know you can't dip your toe in Texas. Texas is a huge financial logistical commitment that will impinge on your ability to put resources into other states. So if he's on the ticket, if he's the presidential nominee or the vice president, that's one thing. If he's running for Senate, I think it's going to be a really tough question for Democrats. Do you try to piggyback on that and in a way that could help him? Or do you say, I need this money now for Milwaukee and Green Bay?
Just another word or two about what happened and people's understanding of what happened. Yeah. The Senate race is kind of unusual, I think, for the Democrats to pick up two seats and lose, what, four at the same time?
Yeah.
I mean, usually the wave kind of goes unidirectionally, right?
With Florida as something of a razor edge anomaly, what happened in the Senate, I think, is revealing of where politics is going. Because if you look, where did Democrats lose seats? They lost seats in Missouri, North Dakota, Indiana, older, preponderantly white, the big rural population, heartland states.
Three incumbents losing.
Yes.
In a year that was good for their party.
Incumbents,
I don't know if that's ever happened.
Incumbents rarely lose when the other party holds the White House. I mean, 2002 with Bush and the 9/11 election was one example, but very rare. This is very unusual. And this is another reason why you feel like something realigning is going on, because the other side is Democrats win two states, both in the Southwest, in kind of younger, diverse Sun Belt states that reflect their emerging coalition in the same way that North Dakota and Missouri reflects kind of the Trump era Republican coalition. And I think in 2020, you're going to see, I think there's enormous pressure on Democrats to find ways to win Senate seats in places like Georgia, North Carolina, Colorado, Texas. Yes, they held the Rust Belt states this time. They held Ohio, they held Pennsylvania, they held Michigan and Wisconsin. But those kind of other heartland, what is the long-term prospects for Democrats in West Virginia or Montana after Manchin or Tester? Not very high. In the long run, I think in every sphere, whether it's the House, but especially the Senate and the Electoral College, in a world in which we're seeing the kind of divides we are demographically between the parties, Democrats have to find ways to make more inroads in the Sun Belt to offset what is likely to be further erosion over time in these older heartland states. So Arizona, Nevada, kind of the flag being planted. In 2020, we'll see Colorado, North Carolina, Georgia, and Texas all have Republican senators who will be running for re-election. Democrats need to find a way to start winning some of those races if they want to be over 50 in the Senate, unless we're going to change the distribution of the Senate to reduce the advantage of South Dakota, North Dakota, Kansas, Wyoming, et cetera. Democrats are going to have to, I think, make some inroads in the Sun Belt because their position in the older heartland states, I just think the long-term trend is toward slow or fast, but it's going to erode.
Yeah, interesting. And in terms of the Republican consultant class and operative class and maybe donor class, it is an interesting question. We're speaking now just before Thanksgiving, yeah. So maybe things will change in the when this air when we put this up in a couple of weeks. But yeah, why they? I guess they just think it's a temporary thing. Maybe it's.
I don't know.
They can't do anything about it.
I don't know. I think. Look,
you think they should be more alarmed than they are?
I think they should be more alarmed than they are. I mean, I think yes, you have a as a Republican Party that is being refashioned even more into a party of older, blue-collar, rural, evangelical white America. You have a structural advantage in the Senate. Great. But when you're losing this many House seats in this many thriving, dynamic communities all across the country, and you're losing ground among the groups that are all growing as a share of the electorate over the next 10 years, if this Trump stamp, if the alignment we saw in this election endures, is that a viable future
but
for
I
the party?
I guess what they would say is, look, Republicans, I mean, the reason it's hard to get Republicans, and I've tried so yes. To get them so large, is they control the presidency, they still control the Senate,
yeah.
They won those close races in Florida and Texas. So it's not clear, you can say that the trends are going this direction or not, but people said that 10, 15 years ago at Florida, and they just defeated an incumbent in Florida who had won in
people
those are huge states,
people,
right?
Yeah, and, people will make that argument. I think that the question of whether you can, how long can you hold North Carolina, Georgia, Texas, certainly Arizona, by surrendering not only younger generations and minority voters, which is there's a lot of overlap in that, but also these unprecedented inroads for Democrats among college whites. Now, admittedly, they don't do as well among college whites in Texas or Georgia at all as they do in Virginia and Colorado. But they're doing a lot better than they were 6 years ago. And it doesn't take as much because of the large minority populations. Yeah, I mean, it's not like Trump can't win in 2020, can't squeeze out another win from this coalition. But again, I go back to that kind of a Cold War question from the arms control debates. Whose hand would you want to play over the next 10 years?
But for the political operatives, if they think maybe Trump can win, or certainly I think from their point of view almost more, that the Republicans can hold the Senate, hold some of these big state governorships like a Florida and a Texas, and they trade off some blue states for red states or whatever. They beat back. I do think losing the marquee elections
had a big impact.
Way people reacted right away. If you were a Republican, it was, thank God we picked up Senate seats. That was kind of the minimal hope was one or two Senate seats. It looked more like three or four that first on election night. The House blowout looked a little less bad than it is, but even so, it's the reversal of the current House, and as we've just seen, you can reverse that again. And the famous, the huge marquee elections, the Republicans squeaked out. So it shows the Republicans still have the muscle to pull this out. I think there's a certain amount, believe me, I'm with you in thinking this is ultimately, not even ultimately, but will prove pretty soon to be self-deception and is underestimating how bad an election it was given how good unemployment was and so forth. But having said all that, I think that's how the Republicans rationalize not looking too hard
and sort of feeling okay about what happened.
Right.
I mean, as I said, I mean, the major change, the biggest change you can probably predict in the electorate between 2018 and 2020 is there'll be more young people voting. Maybe more blue-collar whites voting, which would help Trump, but you're guaranteed, I think, more young people voting.
So there, I think that gets to the real topic we now need to focus on, which is who run the candidates. Because the candidates, in a demography is destiny type politics, candidates matter less. it's harder to swim against the trend. But of course, right. for that on the margin, that's where we're talking thing. 2%, 4%, 6%,
yeah, exactly
1% or half percent in the Wisconsins and Michigans of the world, candidates matter a lot. And I think the other part of Republican overconfidence, if it is overconfidence, might be, well, you know, how are the Democrats going to hold their coalition? It's not so easy for the Democrats. Best case for the Democrats is House races, and that's where they did best. You can run your moderate Republican who's a CIA veteran or a military veteran in certain parts of Virginia, and you can run, you know, Ocasio-Cortez in Queens, Bronx, you know, and everyone gets to think that the party is what they want it to be.
Yes.
But now you can't do that in a presidential race because you have to have one nominee, not
And it is tougher.
Of nominees.
I think
so
it is.
That, I think, is also the Republican. And whatever you think of Trump, he's been through it. He's there. Let's get to the Republican Party and whether there could be a change there, too. But I think for the Trump defenders, they would say, you know, and he was going to lose last time and look what happened. So who's the Democrat? So what about the Democrats? What happens over the next 2 years? What happens in the presidential primaries?
And that, by the way, that point along that the Republicans would make along the way is totally fair. I mean, it is Trump in 2020 could be more formidable than we saw the distribution of the National House popular vote, particularly in those Rust Belt states where he eked out the victory last time. Look, I think this election really underscores the basic strategic choice facing the Democrats because they saw evidence on both sides of the ledger. I mean, as I said before, I mean, I think the basic choice for Democrats is do you try to mobilize the non-voters who are the most alienated from Trump, young people, minorities, especially young minorities, or do you try to reassure the millions of center-right white voters who normally vote Republican, mostly college-educated, who just can't abide Trump on personal and cultural and racial grounds? And this election gave you plenty of evidence for both, right? On the one hand, you saw Democrats winning, according to the exit poll, a majority of college-educated whites, their best performance ever among college white women, a totally competitive performance among college white men. And as we've said, in the upper Midwest states, you even saw a little bit of erosion for Trump among the working class white women. So that would say to you, okay, well, you know, if we have someone who can, all of these pieces are now loose. They've been dislodged from the Republican coalition, and we just got to put our arms around them and pull them in. And that is about a nominee whose greatest strength is reassurance. And I will stop here and say that it is never entirely an either or proposition. I mean, every potential nominee does a little bit of both, but clearly Michael Bloomberg or Joe Biden has a different set of strengths than Kamala Harris and Cory Booker. I mean, there's an emphasis. So one emphasis—
And just to get to that Rust Belt states for a minute, the actual people who won there—
Were really meat and potatoes Democrats.
Yeah.
Really boring.
You know, right.
Really
like
boring.
Bob Casey Jr. in Pennsylvania, the incumbent governor, Gretchen Whitmer.
Fix the damn roads. I mean, you know,
It
was three yards in a cloud of dust.
Right.
And in fact, in those states, you know, so the reassurance is one theory. The other theory, as we said, is mobilization, which is you turn out more younger, particularly younger non-white voters, really, is what we're talking about above all, who don't usually participate. And you know they're going to vote 4-5-1 Democratic, which is much bigger margins than you're talking about among these center-right whites who, you know, on a good day, you're going to get to 54-46 or 55-46 is your goal. Now, there are geographic implications to this demographic choice also, because clearly a mobilization strategy is what you would need to put into play most of these Sun Belt states that we're talking about. And that's certainly Texas, certainly Arizona, North Carolina, Georgia. Florida is kind of a little bit of both. And then on the other hand, the reassurance, there isn't really a mobilization path fundamentally to reclaiming the Rust Belt, I don't think. I mean, yes, you have to improve black turnout in Milwaukee and Detroit from what it was last time. But mostly this is about you're dealing with a constraint of an electorate. It's not Georgia where you have the potential to radically, or Texas, where you could radically change the electorate depending on who the nominee is.
So why wouldn't the pro-reassurance people listening to you here say, but look, this isn't even a close call. You're never going to mobilize people more than you did with Gillum as the governor candidate in Florida, Abrams in Georgia, or Beto in Texas. And we lost all those.
Yeah.
So why isn't this kind of an obvious call that you've got to go for reassurance, go for the Midwest states, still obviously fight Florida and Arizona, and and actually sit him in Arizona was sort of a assurance candidate.
Yeah, she was. She was more
presented herself that way.
And the mobilization candidate for governor got kind of waxed.
So yeah.
Yeah. No. Look, I think the evidence from the 2018 tilts. I will say tilts toward reassurance, in part because the evidence of erosion for Trump in the three states that were critical to his victory is pretty significant in terms of Democrats winning both the governorship and the Senate, but also the exit polls showing his approval stuck at 47 or below in all three, and erosion not only among the college, but also the non-college white women. I mean, that's a pretty compelling set of evidence. On the other hand, I'll give you the other hand, which is, you know, yes, Beto O'Rourke lost in Texas, Stacey Abrams lost in Georgia, and Gillum lost in Florida, a little different in the case. But in case of Beto and Stacey Abrams, when was the last time any Democrat got to 48% in either of those states? I mean, I think in a major race, you may have to go back to Ann Richards in 1990 in Texas and Roy Barnes in 98 in Georgia. So you say, okay.
Right. I think, in fact, the Democrats in Texas, if I'm not mistaken, someone made this point to me. I said, could Beto win? I actually thought maybe he could. And a very savvy Democratic consultant, that was, you know, this is a typical green room conversation before going on the show, said, look, off the record, I mean, no Democrat statewide has gotten above 42%, I think it might be the number, in Texas since 94 when Ann Richards was sort of competitive.
She got 46 in 94.
In her re-election. I may have that number slightly off, but I mean, it's not
John
much.
Sharp in 98 running for lieutenant governor may have been the last one to get close to what
Beto
got.
Not, you know, so not in 20 years.
Right.
And he said, look, so therefore, how much can you get above 42? He did not think you could get to 48 from 42.
40
and I suppose the argument on that side is if you can get to 48, you get to 50
again, the
in
one,
a presidential
year. Yes, that's the point, right? So the reason why the mobilization strategy is not inherently weaker than the reassurance strategy is because more young people will vote. Even though more young people voted than usual in the midterm, more young people still will vote in the presidential, and it will be significantly more, okay? And with the right nominee, it could be, you know, significantly more plus. So, I would think that these results, the fact that if any of the big three had won, Gillum, Abrams, or Beto O'Rourke, I think the momentum in the Democratic Party toward the mobilization strategy would have been really hard to resist. Because in its heart, that's what the party wants to run on.
Yeah.
You know, the party wants to run on mobilizing the emerging diverse America to stand up and say to Donald Trump, we belong here. That's what it wants to run on. And, you know, that isn't what they did run on in 2018. They ran on pre-existing conditions and meat and potatoes, and they avoided that big kind of flags unfurled, flapping in the wind. This is a cultural fight for the meaning of America, because understanding that a lot of the places they had to win, they weren't sure they would win that debate. And in fact, you could certainly make that case about Michigan, Pennsylvania, and Wisconsin. Pennsylvania a little different, but Michigan and Wisconsin. I don't know if you win that debate, if that's the grounds on which you want to fight. But that, to me, is the grounds on which the Democratic Party does want to fight, where the base of the party. What is the moment where Beto O'Rourke became a national phenomenon, right? Wasn't it when he, in a town hall, a leading question encouraging him to condemn the NFL protesters, he gave this impassioned defense that there's nothing more American. And that is what the Democratic Party wants to run. I think that the activist base of the Democratic Party wants the 2020 campaign to be a moment where diverse emerging America says to Trump that your racism is unacceptable.
Right. Now, full throat of repudiation of Trump. And I would say the activist base even wants to say, and incidentally, that's always been under the surface of the Republican Party.
Yes.
And this is just exposing this terrible, you know, aspect of America. And we need to flat out repudiate it.
And all the people,
and that's a tough way to win over people who've been voting Republican much of their lives.
And all the people who, you know, were in charge of actually electing a House they did everything to avoid having that fight. They did not have that. I mean, Katie Porter in Orange County, the vast majority of Democratic candidates avoided the cultural confrontation with Trump and stuck to pre-existing conditions and defending health care, defending Medicare. Okay, now, you know, I don't know if you can do that
in
2020.
And there were heads up from Republican Women for Progress and other groups, which I was told by one Democrat, we were pretty effective in 10 different congressional districts, which were explicitly women from these districts saying, hi, I'm, you know, Jane Jones. I voted Republican for the last 10 or 20 years. I am a Republican, but I can't abide this Republican Party. I can't abide what Trump has done.
Right.
So an explicit defense of the old Republicans almost, and then saying, but it's okay to vote Democratic this time. So that's a very different message from...
Yeah, I don't think there can be a Democrat. First of all, I think the Democratic ticket to me, the likeliest outcome is one from column A, one from column B, a reassurance candidate and a mobilization candidate. And the big question would be, which is on the top of the ticket? I mean, if it's Biden, certainly Kamala Harris or Beto O'Rourke, or I mean, he's going to have to pick someone younger who reflects kind of the activist energy. If it's, if they go the other way, if it's Kamala Harris or Beto O'Rourke who are the nominee, that is more interesting. Do they pick Sherrod Brown, who would be the logical balance to one of them? Or do they just double down, like Clinton did in 92 when he did the generational change with Gore? I mean, you could imagine, I could easily imagine a Joe Biden, Kamala Harris ticket. If I had to pick one ticket today that would be the strongest, that's probably the one I would pick. However, I could also imagine a Kamala Harris, Beto O'Rourke ticket. Like, I don't know if that's the right call, because is that a ticket that can hold Michigan and take back Wisconsin? I don't know, but you could see where you could decide to do that. You could also decide to do, you know, Kamala Harris and Sherrod Brown. I mean, you could, these two pieces will likely both find expression, I think, on the ticket, with the one exception that, a la Clinton Gore, you could imagine mobilize. Like, we're going all the way. We are the new America. We are the emerging next America, Metro America. Look at us, see yourself, and repudiate the kind of overt Wallace-like racism that Trump is offering as a way of kind of trying to divide the country. You know, boy, that would be an election for the ages. That would be like the 1860 election or something. But higher risk. I mean, the other one is kind of a lower risk, don't you think? A lower risk strategy.
Of course, the way the nominating process works is not,
no one controls it.
Right. It's not like, you know, Paul Begala and David Axelrod and, you know, some graybeards from previous administrations get to sit around and say, I think this is a rational way.
I think we talk about
the actual next year in terms of, you got a bunch of 25 candidates, God knows how many exploring, 15, Ron, I suppose, donors, activists. How does that dynamic look to you, both sort of generally and then in terms of particular people? What should we be looking for?
I mean, I think chaotic, obviously, at the beginning, but a Biden running or not is a big
piece. So that's the initial, I agree.
I agree. It's
binary,
a
binary
kind of fork. Yeah, a fork. If he runs, he's kind of the central focal point, the assumed front runner, and either he gets knocked out or he doesn't. I mean, I covered each of his presidential races. He was not good either time. You know, even before he was forced out with the health problems and the Neil Kinnock plagiarism issue the first time in the 80s, and certainly in 2008, didn't make a big impression. However, he matches up well, I think, in the Trump era, because he provides irreverence, a certain amount of irreverence. He doesn't seem like a starch Paul, but vastly more competence. He's actually not a bad matchup against Trump. And he has the potential to be reassuring not only to white-collar whites, but some, maybe not vast, but some blue-collar whites. And as I said, we should file away that, you know, Pennsylvania was a place where the Democrats did regain more ground among working-class whites. I think Pennsylvania is really hard for Trump. So Biden is the first binary choice.
And he'll decide, people seem to think.
Early next year.
Yeah, very early, the end of January.
You know,
so that's probably a moment, moment.
I'm
Bloomberg,
less,
or where, to take the other old famous person? Do you take that seriously as a Democratic?
I think Bloomberg has shown himself to be, you know, he puts megatonnage behind his ideas. So you can't completely dismiss him, I don't think. But having said that, given where the heart, given that Beto, Stacey Abrams, and Andrew Gillum were the three, you know, that's where the energy was in the Democratic Party in 2018. You know, a white guy in his 70s who has stop and frisk in his past.
Right.
That's a hard, that one in particular, the criminal justice stuff.
Yeah.
Again, the heart of the Democratic Party right now is defending this diverse America. And a lot of the Clintonian, and Biden is not going to be immune to this from the crime bill, a lot of the Clintonian kind of opportunity responsibility nexus, which in my mind produced some pretty good policy, but now looks like pandering to white racial resentments to a lot of the Democratic Party. That's a big, I mean, that's going to be a big thing for Biden. More with white liberals probably than with African Americans, actually. Maybe younger African Americans as opposed to older. So, you know, you can imagine a bunch of others in this category. I mean, John Hickenlooper probably isn't vastly different. Or Terry McAuliffe, or if Andrew Cuomo, you know, wakes up and decides to run. I mean, a lot of them are in that group. I personally think it's going to be harder than people expect for Elizabeth Warren or Bernie Sanders, because the history of white progressives who cannot get African Americans to vote for them is that they don't win. It's pretty simple. Like, it's not that complicated. I mean, whether it's Bill Bradley or Gary Hart or, you know, they it just doesn't work. The math doesn't add up. I mean, African-American voters are kind of the ballast of the Democratic primary. I mean, they're not kind of the liberal fringe. They are the ballast. They kind of are the regulator.
They don't show up in the first two states, so.
And then they sort things out.
It can be a little
out.
Misleading. And then sort suddenly then people sort go things south out. And realize.
Like, you know, Obama was polling, I think, roughly 50-50 with Hillary Clinton among African-Americans until he won Iowa.
Yeah.
Like, they wanted proof that he was viable.
And that it.
Okay. So if you have, you say, okay, the reassuring, you know, are mostly, and mostly white men. You have kind of the progressive, older whites again. And then you have kind of the younger, diverse candidates, of whom I think Kamala Harris is the most formidable potentially, as a woman. I mean, college white, I mean, I don't know this, I'm making this up number slightly, but I'm guessing college white women and African-American women between them are something like 35 to 40% of the Democratic primary. Maybe even a little more, maybe like north of 40.
Yeah.
So you have someone who can appeal to both of those groups. Like, if it came down to Kamala Harris versus Elizabeth Warren one-on-one, I would put my money on Kamala Harris. I just don't think, I think demographically she has a wider reach. And then you have like Cory Booker, you have Deval Patrick. The biggest wild card, I think, is Beto O'Rourke. I mean, I think that he
could say a little bit about that. That's not just a media phenomenon. That no, he I think could it's, lose I think, and then run for president.
I mean, yeah. Well, Abe Lincoln did it.
Lincoln,
I mean,
yes. Yeah, Lincoln analogy.
There's only one example, but it's a good one. Maybe there's other examples. I don't know of another
no,
example.
No, I think it's, yeah, fairly unique. Yeah.
You know, of course, to complete the analogy, Ted Cruz would have to primary and beat Trump, and then it would be like Stephen Douglas beating Lincoln in 1858, and then Lincoln beating him 2 years later. Look, I think that there is a generational lane as well in the Democratic Party and in the general election. I mean, I think I've said to you before, I don't know if I've said it on camera, that like Gary Hart, 84, is a good candidate against Trump. You don't have to run left-right against Trump. You can just run future past. You can have somebody who can basically say, you know, it's great that he's reopening coal mines. How many of you in the audience think your kid is going to go to work in a coal mine? Okay, let's talk about the future, you know. So if I had a bet today, my three front runners for the Democratic nomination are Biden, Kamala Harris, and Beto O'Rourke. I don't have Elizabeth Warren in there because I think she taps out at this kind of, and maybe she's a finalist if she runs, but I think she taps out myself. Now, I could be wrong, and I think she is a relatively weak choice to put up against Trump for a lot of reasons. But I think Biden, Harris, and Beto O'Rourke all, Biden being the reassurance candidate, Harris being the mobilization candidate, and Beto being, you know, really neither, more of the Gary Hart future past, different, a whole different lens on the election, but more mobilization than reassurance, certainly. I think they are each intriguing options for Democrats, and it would not surprise me if two of those three are on the ticket in 2020, unless Beto decides to run against Cornyn.
You think the younger, I guess to use this, reassurance candidates, which I would say would be Michael Bennett, the senator from Colorado, or Mitch Landrieu, the former mayor of New Orleans.
I think it's hard for them.
Do they go anywhere?
Sherrod Brown is the one that's kind of interesting.
Yeah, but he cuts across.
He's like, he's acceptable, I think, to the Bernie Sanders side. But he is rumpled enough, and he's shown enough appeal to blue collar that he has some elements of reassurance. I think he is popular in the African-American community in his own state, although what that would mean against Kamala Harris, say, is or Cory Booker is probably pretty limited. Again, once they establish their viability. I mean, I don't think the African-American Democratic primary voters have not shown that they take flyers. They want to know that their vote matters. Julian Castro is kind of interesting, and he's someone maybe, you know, we'll be talking about if Beto decides to run for Senate in 2020. But I kind of think of those as the big three in my mind, actually, in Biden, Harris, and O'Rourke.
You'll find someone we haven't even mentioned, you know, that'll be.
Well, there's Howard
Trump,
Schultz.
In the Trump,
Well, again, so like there are more, most of those we haven't mentioned are reassuring white guys, business guys, you know, who would kind of.
I mean.
I don't think that's where the party's heart is.
I mean, one of the questions is, does the party want someone who will denounce Trump as he deserves to be denounced as they see it, or someone who will try to tell a few Trump voters, hey, look, I understand why you went that way in 2016. It wasn't crazy. There's a lot to be upset about, but I'm really going to drain the swamp and clean things up. That's a very different tone.
2018,
you can combine them a little bit.
2018, they picked the latter mostly. There were a few people who did the former. Gillum was one who did the former. Again, I think the political professionals would probably prefer the latter. the heart of the party wants the former.
Right.
And one advantage Biden has is he kind of does both.
Yeah.
Can I say about that?
Please.
So can you, it's easy to imagine Biden basically going into working class communities and saying, Trump is selling you short. He thinks you're all a bunch of racists. He thinks that he can give tax breaks to his rich friends and divert you by making nasty comments about Mexicans and right. and African Americans. You know what? I know you. I grew up on the block, you know, and Mr. O'Connor down the block, you know, if a guy did his job on the line next to him, he didn't care if he was black or white or yellow or green. Like, he could basically go into, he can basically do both. I mean, he could go into working class communities, attack Trump as racist without attacking them, basically saying Trump is selling you short. So he has options that other Democrats right. don't in terms of how to straddle that. But I don't think you get away, as I've said probably five times, I don't think you get away from being the Democratic nominee in 2020 without directly accusing Trump of using racism to divide the country. I think that is the sine qua non that the party is going to demand of its nominee.
I mean, the great, you know, we'll come back to that in a second, it's so interesting, because we say generally, and people like us talk reassurance versus mobilization or confrontation or whatever, but of course that always manifests itself in some issue or set of issues
yeah.
or maybe a symbolic moment.
Right.
Clinton would have been welfare reform, I would
yeah.
say, and then Sister Soldier in a sense,
right.
which made him a new Democrat. For all that people like us might have known of him, and he had a think tank, he was interested in new Democratic ideas, and he was surrounded by people who were interested in that, changing the Mondale-Dukakis trajectory of the party. For the voters, it needed to have an expression. And I think one question would be, what could the expression of that on either
right,
side be?
Right.
I want to get back to that in a second. But on the Biden, I mean, it would be ironic, I suppose, if Biden, having run twice and lost, this is actually the best time for him personally and for his message. But maybe he's just too old. I mean, that would be
2016, in yes. retrospect, looks like a pretty
and
good time.
And Jerry Brown is the other person
right.
who's run, what, two or three times?
Three.
Pretty good races a couple of times.
76,
some
he
states.
Ran well. Yeah. 76, he won a bunch of states.
I mean, now, if he were 10 years, if either of those people were 5 or 10 years younger.
Yeah. Jerry Brown, especially.
Sitting two-term governor of California,
Jerry Brown would be perfect to run against. Again, Jerry Brown, even in his 60s, could do future past.
Yeah.
Because I do think that there is this, as I said, the most logical frame to run against Trump is left-right, but there is just a whole other, like Macron is a good candidate.
Right.
Against Trump,
right,
you know,
right.
And Gary Hart, 84. I mean, the way Gary Hart would have run against Reagan,
right?
Someone could run against Trump,
right? So, what issue? So,
yeah,
I think it's interesting what you said, that you need to be indignant about his
race.
Divisiveness and about the use of race and the attacks on immigrants,
women,
I suppose.
Women, right? Horse face.
I mean, that's fair enough to be indignant about that.
Yeah.
But what are the? I mean, I've been struck, I guess I'll just say, so speaking to various, you know, random audiences, the Medicare for All stuff has become like a symbolic,
right,
no one even knows what it is.
I am in the wrong camp on this, because I think there's a pretty easy way out.
Yeah.
Okay, so, you know.
But you agree it's become like a weird,
almost litmus test. But here's the question. So if you run on a, you know, Medicare for All means a lot of different things for people.
Right.
If you mean Medicare for All meaning single payer healthcare in which the government eliminates private insurance, and has to, you know, raise taxes by over $1 trillion to do so.
Right.
That is a big burden to carry into the general election. I think it is, whatever people poll on it now, the case against it hasn't been made, and right. I think if you make the case against it, I don't think you can win that argument. But I don't think you have to make that argument, because I think there is an intermediary step that really, to me, threads the needle pretty easily, which would be acceptable in a Democratic primary and defensible in a general election, and that is a Medicare buy-in for all. Essentially, Medicare does not replace private insurance, but you allow more people right. to buy into Medicare on the private exchanges, maybe starting at 55 and lowering it over time. It's an expanded public option. And it seems to me like that would be, and I wouldn't be surprised if that emerges legislatively
right.
in the next 2 years.
Now, my gut instinct is similar to that, which I'll just generalize by saying that I don't think the basic policy issues end up being wildly divisive.
Yeah.
Now, stuff could emerge in the next 18 months that would greatly divide the Democratic Party. One can imagine a foreign policy fight or an intervention.
The trade stuff might.
The trade stuff, maybe.
That plays out.
But one sort of feels like the cultural indicators that some Democrat, if he wanted to go to the center, would find a way. That would be Sister Soldier, you know, show that he's in favor of He's against excessive political correctness. He's against intolerance of the left. He's in favor of letting conservative scholars speak on campus. I mean, some way of sort of being signaling.
Trump makes that so hard, you know, because.
Well, that's the question.
That's the problem.
And then on the other side, I guess, on the progressive side, you know, what becomes their way of, I don't know, signaling that they're not like the old accommodationist Democrats who've gotten crushed, who've been ineffectual in their view. And
expand the Supreme Court? I mean, I don't know.
Well, that's what I wanted. Well, something I wonder, like that. You can imagine that.
Will anybody run on it? I mean, if there are 25 candidates, someone will probably run
on
expanding the Supreme
Court. Totally,
and
I wondered about that. Why would that wouldn't be? You can get some, there's a very, they're well-known professors at Harvard Law School and elsewhere who were defending it, given
Steve
McConnell.
Calabrese wanted term limits. But that needs a constitutional amendment, so that's
right.
Harder.
No, but
no,
I think Mike Klarman said, you know, given what McConnell
Puerto
did.
Puerto Rico a state. Make Puerto Rico and D.C. states.
Yeah, exactly. Real one man, one vote, or one person, one vote. And given what McConnell did in 2016 and given Kavanaugh as they see it and all that, I mean, with Roosevelt, he didn't lay the groundwork for it. It, of course, was a big mistake, or people think it was. But I totally agree with that. If one
voting
even
rights,
fringy
new
candidate
voting rights act,
does that,
well,
you know,
the voting rights act will be in a center.
Yeah, but if I agree, if one even semi-fringy candidate
expands the Supreme Court,
maybe by, you know, 2 months later, half of them are for it.
Yes.
You know?
You know, I do believe.
So it's a very dynamic process, you know, I mean.
I think that the Democratic nominee in 2020 will go through the same kind of weighing and costs and balances that we saw in the House races in 2018. On the one hand, as we've said, what the party most wants is a full-throated defense of diverse new America against Trump's attempt to divide along racial grounds. And so you can imagine different ways in which that plays out, besides condemning Trump, a new Voting Rights Act, commitment to police reform. I mean, a lot.
Right.
So that will be there. The harder question is, beyond saying I'm going to defend Medicare and Medicaid and I'm going to defend the ACA, what is, if anything, your economic agenda for, Trump country and these blue-collar whites that you're trying to win back at least a few of? I disagree. I mean, people say that Hillary had no agenda for these folks. I think that's not quite right. I mean, she may have, you know, it got subsumed, obviously, because she wanted to talk only about Trump being morally unfit to be president. But she really had a whole bunch of stuff about helping people balance work and home, which is very relevant to blue-collar families, about expanded pre-care and expanded child care and tax credit, I mean, all that kind of stuff. So, like, what do you say if you're basically saying, okay, you're going to say to working-class white women in these key Midwestern states, you're going to say that if you re-elect the Republicans, they're coming for your health care, and that if you re-elect the Republicans, they're going to go after your Medicare and Social Security because they have to pay for their tax cut. What's the third thing you say to them? Like, what do you say to them about how I'm going to make your life better? I think you end up back in the same place that Clinton did. You end up back in, I'm going to help you balance work and home. That's kind of missing, right? What is the new...
But constrained by a big budget deficit.
Huge budget deficit.
Maybe there'll be a little bit of recession and suddenly the
deficit gets
bigger.
Well, I'll raise...
And they don't want to cut defense spending,
The corporate tax rate 2 points to fund universal pre-K.
But they're on a slightly dangerous, even though I think it's perfectly respectable for liberal economists to complain about a lot of the Trump tax cut and for politicians to denounce parts of it. That's traditionally a slippery slope for Democrats to start down, where voters think if they're going to raise that one, they say they'll raise that one little tax, but then you know what? The Democrats love raising taxes.
And I think I've talked to enough Democrats who felt that, this goes to your history, you know, when you were writing your memos in the early 1990s against Clinton Care, and you were worried that Stan Greenberg was right, because Stan Greenberg and Democrats said, look, we are going to show the white working class that government doesn't exist only to take their money and give it to people they think don't deserve it. We're going to give them a tangible benefit. And I remember in your memos, you warned about the political implications that they succeeded in doing that. Well, you know, fast forward 25 years, the universal pre-K and the tuition-free public university were modern manifestations of that same impulse among Democrats. Say, we have to show middle and lower middle income white people that that their tax dollars, you know, will produce something tangible. They have not sold that, particularly the universal tuition-free public college is not viewed, I believe, that positively by these swing voters. So if that is not the way to convince them that a Democratic economic agenda will benefit them and their kids, the question of what is looms kind of big, because I don't think there is another unless I've missed it in the last 2 years, there's not some other set of ideas. You know, maybe it's more about working in vocational training, and, you know, people don't like the idea that, like, their kids have to go to college because it makes you feel like you're, you know, they're looking down on you because you didn't. But Democrats have not solved that piece of it. And again, I think 80% of the election is going to be culture, myself. I mean,
Culture, let's talk about the culture stuff, though. Was there ways to be, so on O'Rourke, and you followed more closely than I did, I'm sure, he both defended Kaepernick and, you know, kneeling during the national, but he also, didn't he at one point defend, rebuke people for, I don't know, attacking, you know, sort of yelling at Ted Cruz in a restaurant.
He was
sort of McCain-like in his, you know, respect for the tradition. McCain likes too strong, but, you know, he didn't present himself as
He affirmed the new America without condemning the old. Trump or the old, right. And that is a way to go. And Biden would do that, although Biden would condemn Trump.
Right.
Like Biden would try to separate Trump from his supporters.
But he would defend the old America as well as the new.
He would.
Or
Biden
at least.
Would.
Yes,
and others. I don't know if Harris or Booker could do that.
So that's, I think, a big distinction among the Democrats.
Right.
And I think that doesn't just get to the working class voters they need in those upper Midwest states, but it gets to the college-educated white voters.
Men. And I think
even
the women.
Some of the women.
I think the women are, like, don't forget, like, Trumpism is about resisting cultural and demographic change in every form. So if you look at the polling, not only are Trump voters uneasy about more immigrants and all that, or much less black protesters in the NFL, they're also pretty uneasy about the changing role of women. I mean, like, including the women Trump supporters. You know, women Trump supporters are much more likely than women Clinton supporters to say that the trend of more women working outside of the house has made it harder to raise kids, harder to have healthy marriages, all of that. So if you're a college white woman, you know, in a suburb, as what we learned, in a suburb anywhere, you're looking at this whole package and saying, it is denigrating me. It is saying that I am somehow wrong. I'm making the wrong choices for my family. I'm kind of undermining what the country should be. And that is, like I said, everybody got the joke. Everybody who is the implicit target of Trump's appeals to restoration understood what he was doing.
But I talked to some Republicans who said, for Kavanaugh, for instance, which I think probably helped Republicans in the red states as a cultural thing, a fight. But I think they were, even in the swing congressional districts, Northern Virginia, where I live, I think the Democrats I knew were relieved that the Kavanaugh thing ended and went away.
Yeah.
Because there were college-educated whites, including women, especially the men, but even including the women, it was sort of like, geez, I don't know, we can't just have people making a charge from 30 years ago. That could be my, I mean, everyone ridiculed when Trump said it. That could be your husband, that could be your son. But of course, people really were thinking that too.
There was a huge gap. I know in the polling, there was a huge gap between college and non-college white women on whether who they believed, Blasey Ford or Trump or Kavanaugh. But yes, I think you're right. I mean, again, but that goes with the larger thing. Democrats did not want to have the cultural fight in 2018. And I think the professionals, by and large, are not going to really want to have it in 2020. You know?
Right.
I mean,
professionals meaning the
political professionals.
Yeah.
Because I think they will view that everyone who is motivated by that understands. They recognize that Trump is targeting them. And they will show up. And that the last people you need are more likely, as you said before, to be offended than drawn to you. On that, with the exception, you know, I do think, I mean, you can answer this. I think part of the problem Republicans have now in the Trump era is that in white collar suburban America, you could not wear a MAGA hat to a party.
Right.
It is culturally unacceptable. You are basically saying, I am okay with George Wallace-like arguments from the White House. And it's been culturally delegitimized, I think, because Trump has so overtly, you know, calling, that's a stupid question. That's a racist question. You know, she's a, Maxine Waters, low IQ individual. I mean, the degree to which he has stripped any veil from what he is doing. The caravan is coming, you know, Democrats want open borders. What did he say? They're gonna be taking over your towns. And, you know, I mean, I thought, like, in some ways the most memorable single quote from a voter in the whole 2018 election was that woman in Minnesota at a Trump rally who said, you know, all the vacation homes up on the lakes are left unattended all winter. What's to stop the caravan from coming in and occupying them? And I'm going to go back there next spring, and there's going to be a Honduran mother and her daughter living in my cabin. You know, okay, great. Great for where that is. In Northern Virginia, the price of that is don't wear your MAGA hat in public.
Right. I do think on the caravan, it was interesting. To the degree it backfired, and I don't know if we really know if it did, but it seems to have backfired post-election, at least. A lot of that, though, was because he deployed the troops. And so the Democrats got to be the pro, respecting the military.
Well,
don't misuse the military.
Backfire is the wrong word. It intensified like everything else. Yeah. It certainly helped them in the places where the red states, and also look, in the House, they did draw the line. They did build a firewall at the outer suburbs. I mean, Democrats penetrated hardly any beyond that.
Right, it could have been 50 or 60 seats if they and had a collapse.
They did not have a collapse in rural America,
right.
But they had a comprehensive collapse in suburban America. And look, even without the gerrymanders in Ohio, North Carolina, and Texas, the suburban swell would have taken another 7 or 8 seats. I mean, it would have been close to 50. You look at the results, for example, Franklin County, Columbus, in that rematch of the Balderson-O'Connor thing, the Democrat got 60% plus again in Franklin, but there was enough rural attached to it. Same thing in North Carolina in the seats around Charlotte and Raleigh, where those areas went even more Democratic, there was enough rural. Now, Trump can win those states that way again in 2020 because there is enough rural to offset. Right. But I look at in Arizona, there isn't.
Yeah. But I do think somehow this is where the cultural stuff gets so complicated in a way. I agree, can you be sort of pro-military? I mean, Hillary tried that not very effectively in 2016, I guess.
Right.
The most pro-military convention
of any
of either party.
Yeah.
But maybe there are other ways to do that. And it is a risk if the Democrats look like they are simply the party of
kind of the changing America. Because you don't know
the changing America and a changing America that has contempt for
the old.
The old,
yes.
And will in effect persecute the old almost for
and
being the way they've been.
Right.
So if you said something 30 years ago somewhere or even, I'm exaggerating.
And you can't win Michigan.
Or you say something in a class, your kid says something in a class that the teacher doesn't like, suddenly you're going to be in hauled up in court or something.
And unless
you can't be that persecuting.
Yes, and the reality is that unless you're going to mobilize enough of the new voters to win Georgia, Florida, Texas, Arizona, you can't win that way. There is no escaping the need to recapture. If you can't replace it with Sun Belt mobilization, there's no escaping the need to have Rust Belt reassurance, right? I mean, there's you cannot have working class white voters, especially women. I mean, the men are gone. They're gone. Even in this election, a little better in Wisconsin. The other two was still like comparable to anywhere else. 70% of non-college white men voted Republican in Pennsylvania, roughly. 70% approved of Trump, at least. But you can't make the Electoral College add up unless you can convince a certain share. You go back to what we were talking about. Unless you can levitate in the upper Midwest above your national number among working class white voters. So yeah, you can't have them thinking that you think that they are kind of retrograde, there has to be a place for them. And that's not easy. I mean, it's not easy to condemn Trump's appeals to racism without implying that his supporters are okay with it,
right?
Which many of them are.
That's where I think the generational thing could allow the Democrats to square the circle a little bit. They sort of embody the new America. Mm-hmm. But with O'Rourke seemed like he was better at that, without condemning the.
All right. And look, as I said, I think Biden can. I don't think this would be usually hard for Biden. I think it'd be hard for a lot of other people. Very hard.
I mean, Amy Klobuchar. There are sort of individuals you can Mike Bennett, but they're just not well known, and it's hard to know if they could ever really. I mean, if Biden didn't run, I suppose one of them might emerge. Mm-hmm. Landrieu, I'd say Landrieu's Confederate Monument speech probably is the actual best example of that.
Of doing that.
Yeah, as mayor of a southern city, obviously New Orleans.
Right, you could see that. I mean, there are ways to do it. I mean, it's just hard because there's somebody on the other side of the net, right?
Yeah. Well,
so Trump is going to take your words,
right,
whatever you say, and portray them as disrespecting not him but his voters.
Right.
He's going to take whatever you say, however you try to chastise or constrain Trump for his appeals to racial resentments, he's going to take it and say, the Democrats think you're racists.
And on the Republican side, briefly, I mean, I can make an argument. I've seen polling in focus groups that suggest there's a little less support for Trump than you think. People can approve of Trump retrospectively, but not be confident about renominating or reelecting him. I do think there'll be a primary challenge, and it'll be more substantial than people think. Having said that, are you going to pour cold water here on my not much evidence of an intra-party rebellion against Trump at this point.
Look, I think the divide is very clear. College and non-college Republicans are now roughly half of the primary each. Trump dominated non-college Republicans in 2016, but he only won a third of college-educated Republicans, even in 2016. It's the first time we've had a split between the college and non-college side, and the non-college side won. So Romney and McCain both had exactly the opposite profile. If you look at the total exit poll, cumulative for the whole thing, they each won half of the college Republicans and one third of the non. Right, so like you had Santorum and Huckabee as more of the non. So Trump always, it wasn't like the college side of the Republican Party overwhelmingly embraced him to begin with. And
they voted for him in 2016 against Hillary.
Against Hillary.
Judges.
And in this election, clearly, independent voters who normally vote Republican, college-educated, independent white voters normally vote Republican, many of them voted Democratic. So it is, you know, the most likely outcome of a primary challenge is with the right nominee, the right challenger, you could mobilize a substantial portion of the college side of the Republican Party against Trump, particularly where independents can vote. And you would get a decent vote among them. But you might win them 60-40 and then lose the non-college side 80-20. I mean, the non-college embrace of Trump in the Republican Party makes it hard to imagine him losing the nomination. But that doesn't mean to me, as I think I've said to you before, that a primary challenge is meaningless. Because if a challenger in the primary is able to reinforce the message of 2018, which is that there is a price to this, guys. Okay, look at just what happened in Northern Virginia and Southern New Hampshire and the suburbs of New York and Orange County in California in the primaries. In all of these places, half or more of these, in these white collar places, half or more of Republican voters said, we don't want this. And okay, yeah, the majority of the party still says they want it, but you can't win national elections with all of those people getting off the bus. And I said to you before, you don't have to prove you're a majority of the party as a dissent, as a dissenting force. You just have to prove that the party can't win without you, I think. And I think that is what 2018 proved, though very few Republicans are kind of accepting that. And I think a 2020 primary challenge, whether or not it dislodges Trump, could really underscore, highlight, put neon marking around the depth of the college white, normally Republican, recoiling from him in a way that I think becomes harder for the party to ignore.
And what events do you think could happen in 2019? I guess two categories, real world events, recession, foreign policy crises, Mueller, or political events, I guess, which would have to do with how the House and the Senate and the presidency interact, that would either strengthen or weaken. Well, I'm curious in general what you think, how much are we sort of set on a path to 2020, and these events will happen on the side, and basically the two armies are marching down the road anyway, or how much do the events really affect what happens in general? And then I think in particular on the intra-Republican side, I'm curious.
So I mostly think the two armies are marching down the road, but obviously big events are big events.
Yeah, recessions.
Right. If the economy, Donald Trump's at 40 to 45 with 4% unemployment. You know, he'll probably be a little, he'll be a little lower. I don't know if he'll be vastly lower, but he'll be a little lower if the economy is slower. And certainly Mueller is, you know, I mean, that matters. I mean, you know, what he says will matter. And I think will matter, the kind of voters I'm talking about are the ones who pay the most attention to things like that. He's in this kind of situation. He's in kind of a precarious situation where he's not doomed by any means, but he's hardly thriving. And he hasn't had a full-scale foreign policy disaster yet. So I kind of think that all of those things are more downside risk than upside risk. For Trump, is the economy possibly going to be better in 2020? Is the world going to be more? I mean, I suppose he could get a big concession out of China that would complicate the Democratic path in the Rust Belt. That could happen, I suppose. That could strengthen him. But I think mostly we are heading for a cultural reckoning and division, in which at the margin, Democrats are hoping to persuade a small number, relatively small number of white people in the Midwest who may lean toward Trump on culture that he really doesn't have your back on your economic interest, as kind of an important sideshow within that, but that the fundamental divide is the cultural division that we are just marching toward. We're kind of like, you know, it's sort of like those medieval armies. We're assembling.
Yeah, we're in the trenches.
We're in the trenches. We're assembling. All the shields are going up, and we're getting ready for the next time the two lines run into each other, kind of like either Braveheart or Lord of the Rings.
Clarence Thomas resigns from the court in July of 2019, because he's been there for a long time. It's hard to believe, but what, 28 years, something like that?
92 was he, 91? 91, 91 20 years.
And he, and so there's another confirmation fight. Who does that help?
Is it
a big wild card, or is it just a thing that
happens? It does what this one did.
Just reinforces everything.
Reinforces. I mean, it helps Republicans in small town rural, and it compounds their problem in metro.
Probably has a pretty big effect, don't you think? Some effect in the Democratic primary. I think if you're a reassurance candidate, your life is made harder by that,
it is
right?
It's made harder. And again, Biden is the unique reassurance candidate because he can attack Trump while being a reassurance candidate, a little harder for the others. This idea that the coalition of transformation may represent an absolute majority of the population, but the other side will control the Supreme Court for the next 15 years is a kind of a fuse that it's just like it's hard to imagine the Herb Stein rule. What was it exactly? No trend that can't be sustained will be, or any trend that can't be sustained won't be.
Right.
Like the idea that for the next 15 years, you know, essentially a white male Republican bloc on the Supreme Court will be restricting the ability of this emerging America to advance its interests on everything from affirmative action to voting rights to criminal justice. I don't think you have 15 years of that. I mean, that's what the actuarial tables will tell you. But I say there will be some intervening political event, something like an effort to expand the court.
Switch in time.
The switch in time that saved
nine. So, court session, Roberts decides not to be.
Roberts decides not to allow an endless series of racially charged 5-4 decisions.
Yeah.
I'm not sure the filibuster will last through the rest of our lives.
Yeah, unless Trump gets reelected, and then it's a whole different question. There are a lot of that the court. I think I tend to agree. That's a sort of under. People just focus on the court when there's a nomination or when there's one dramatic decision, a couple at the end of term. But that's an underrated issue.
Let me tell you,
I guarantee it helps Trump hugely among the Republicans.
The Shelby County decision and the voting rights will be a much bigger part of the Democratic primary in 2020 than it was in 2016. I mean, the idea that creating national pushback against the Republican states that have done all sorts of things on voter ID, it's a very tangible way to kind of express your solidarity with the emerging America. And I think all of the Democratic, I guarantee you the Democratic nominee in 2020 will have a very robust answer for Brian Kemp as Secretary of State of Georgia or Texas. I mean, they will try to create national something or promise national something.
And finally, I guess Mueller, I mean, just that is kind of a big inflection point. Let's assume a report comes out in 2 months. I mean, let's just oversimplify. Either it basically doesn't find something impeachable for Trump or plausibly impeachable, or it does. If it doesn't, Trump declares victory. This was always a witch hunt, and I said it was a witch hunt, and see, they didn't find, they indicted a few people for trivial violations of things, he'll say. I mean, how much of a victory is it for Trump? Does it really change the dynamics? And conversely, if he finds something plausibly impeachable, then we do have a 2019, which, so Democrats, can they...
Right. They
Our friends, the Democratic strategists, can sit all they want in the green rooms and say, I kind of don't want that.
But
what are they going to do? Say, well, the special counsel, whom everyone's been praising to the skies for the last 2 years, has found the following evidence of possible collusion or obstruction, but we're going to ignore it here in the House. Now that we control the House, we're not going to... Doesn't Jerry Nadler have to have hearings?
I haven't thought this through entirely, but is it possible that it's basically self-correcting, that if Mueller doesn't find something, they have the excuse not to do anything? If Mueller does find something, it's Mueller. It's not them.
Yes.
Yeah,
but how
much
does it change American politics for 2020 if 2019 features impeachment or possible impeachment or, Clinton in 2018?
Right.
That
is
impossible.
It's
probably not likely, I would say, but is it a 1 in 4 chance? Probably.
Well, the Republicans don't remove him without question. So he's still president in 2020.
Unless there's a real smoking gun.
Unless there's an email from Putin or something. Right. So I think it doesn't change it that much.
Yeah. I mean, I guess that might be the funny thing after all the drama, right?
You know, if Democrats vote to impeach him on a party line basis, but based on basically ironclad, evidence from Mueller, I think that is seen correctly as essentially a symbolic event that voters ultimately have to render a verdict on in 2020, and that the portions of the country that are alarmed by Trump are reinforced. The Republican, and you know, I would wonder in that, the thing I would wonder about most would be college white men.
So I think it's an intro, I think it probably has more effect among Republicans.
Interesting.
That is, you know, in the sense that a sort of sense of, oh my God, it was bad, it wasn't just a witch hunt, and God knows what else there is, and can you re-nominate the guy then after this is one thing.
That could be.
I mean, even with Clinton, incidentally, for all that he was so popular while he was being impeached and afterwards, I don't know if it had been in his first term, would people have just said, you know, fine, I mean, we're going to put him back on the ballot. It was, you know, it was Gore, not he. So,
yeah, would they have put him back on the ballot?
It could be an intra-Republican issue.
It could be.
You know, more than the two parties, I suppose.
You know, and again, I think the question for the intra-Republican is, can you find any way to talk to Trump's working class base? Yeah. Because otherwise, it's not, as I said, it's not just a futile gesture in the sense that you could be making a very powerful point that shows the clear risk to the party of the direction they're headed, reinforcing the message of 2018. But I don't think you can't win, obviously, or even really seriously threaten him unless you can go beyond the white collar parts of the party that were most hesitant about him to begin with.
Final point.
Yes.
I think I said that a couple times. Third party independent candidates, yeah. The perpetual dream, two party systems weaker than ever, though it's somehow both stronger than ever and weaker than ever.
Right.
But maybe that's the problem, actually. It's both like stronger in mobilization, but weaker in
kind of its hold on the public imagination. Yeah. Look, I mean, you would have to say that eventually, I mean, if you have Trump versus a very left Democrat, there will be a lot of voters who don't feel that either reflects them.
Right.
And that is real. I mean, and so in that sense, there is without question an opening. The problem is that because the choice is so stark, people who lean one way or the other, even a millimeter, are going to be very hesitant about voting for that third party and advantaging the other. I mean, if you are a slightly left of center woman in outside of Des Moines, are you going to vote for the Kasich Hickenlooper ticket if you think it's going to make Trump president again?
Well, the story of 2018, and I have a lot of friends who were in that space, you know, they had pretty attractive independent candidates, and they were hoping this would be the year where everyone would get sick of both parties. It was the opposite.
It was the opposite, right.
Kobach got the nomination in Kansas.
Yes.
Greg Orman, who had done well as an independent in 2014 in the Senate race, is running for governor. The people I know who were friendly to Orman were like, that's great. It was great. But, I mean, they've nominated the most unacceptable Republican they could have to moderate Republicans.
Right.
The Democrat was a kind of conventional, I don't know, liberal Democrat. And this is a real opening up the middle. The opposite happened.
Because the stakes seem so high.
The former moderate Republican governors and senators from the state said, okay, we're endorsing the Democrat.
The stakes seem so
high. So this is the irony, right?
Right.
People,
in the Trump era,
The
choice is so stark, so delineated, that no one wants to take a chance of messing around with making any kind of gesture. I mean, I think I said to you before, you know, at Stalingrad, no one was checking people's loyalty to the party.
Right.
That's the way it feels in American politics for many people at this point.
So I suppose that might suggest, just to ridiculously think beyond 2020, that, I mean, who knows, but you can imagine the crack-up comes after 2020 in one or either party. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? In a funny way, in 2020 is the mobilization. But if, let's just say Trump loses to Biden or something, you know, who's probably a one-term president, one could imagine, of course, a huge civil war in the Republican Party then. Mm-hmm. Was that all a horrible mistake, or do we just need a better version of Trumpism, you know, and that war? Democrats, who knows, would depend how they would govern, I suppose, and all that. But so I guess the transformational moment, if there ever is to be one in the party system,
to me, the question
is post-2020, it seems to be on this, right?
Yes, but I think the result may be a little more baked than you do, in that these kinds of changes in the party composition tend to be self-reinforcing.
Right.
If in fact, Trump loses in 2020, or whether he wins or loses in 2020, he is pushing out of the party more of the upper middle class whites who are most resistant to his kind of ethno-nationalism. So there's less to fight with. Like I said, the last few Republican primaries have been 50-50 college, non-college. I'm not sure that's going to be the case this time. Right? It might be majority non-college. And then conversely, yes, the reassurance candidate may be the right choice for Democrats in 2020, but the future of the Democratic Party clearly looks more like Beto and Kamala Harris than it does like Biden and Bloomberg.
Right.
I mean, the inescapable metro secular white collar white plus young minority you know, with the working class whites moving to the edge of the coalition, critical in some places, but not the driving force, that seems to be inexorable. I mean, I think the future nominees are going to look more like Beto and Kamala Harris than they are like Biden.
But that could strain the Democratic coalition, depending on what issues come up. This is not as if you all have the exact same interests and views.
And the taxes are the one, right? I mean, that you see that in a place like California. How much can you tax your culturally aligned white upper middle class supporters in order to fund programs that mostly benefit your lower income and non-white younger supporters?
And things like the military, it's symbolically, you can say, as long as Trump's sending troops to the border, you know, for a ridiculous political reason, everyone can agree that that's terrible. Yeah. We like the troops they don't deserve to.
Right.
If you're actually talking about an actual foreign policy decision, the Hillary Clinton, let's call it, wing of the Democratic Party looks pretty different, I suspect, from the progressive, you know, younger,
but I do think,
or maybe the younger voters become more, forget the old fights that made their parents were dovish, become more hawkish again. Look at Putin.
Where I start. I see a lot of topspin in the trends we're living through. And unless there is a really focused, almost heroic effort in the Republican Party to expunge Trumpism, and it's hard to do because Trump himself did not come out of nowhere. He kind of intensified things that other Republicans had done. Then I think it gets progressively harder to reassert a more racially neutral, inclusive small government. You know, what Paul Ryan was 5 years ago.
Right.
Because the people who had supported a kind of said, I don't belong here anymore. And then conversely, as I said, on the Democratic Party, this was a Rubicon election for Democrats. It was the first election ever where a majority of their House candidates were not white men.
Yeah.
And that's the future. I mean, look, they are the diverse coalition. I mean, it will not be too long before a majority of the Democratic presidential candidates' votes come from minorities. Clinton was in the mid-40s. At some point, before too long, a majority of their votes will come from non-whites. Obviously, a majority of their votes come from women. That is going to have to reflect it in who they ran. And you know, along those lines, just think about what happened in this election. Democrats got their highest share ever among college white women, and meanwhile nominated an unprecedented number of college white women, and kind of sent the signal, reinforced the signal. Okay, this is where you belong. And again, I will end on this note, which is Republican, not elected officials who have to worry about voters, but like the people who worry about electing Republicans. Can you look at these kind of trends and say, I want to play this hand for the next decade, as opposed to the hand that Trump is effectively ceding to the other side?
And I think their answer will be, you know, I might agree with you privately, Ron, but here we are. And I mean, if you're this Republican who's kind of go along, get along, have real candidates in the real world, can't be like Bill Kristol sitting on the outside, imagining a different future. And this is the hand we've got to play, and we'll hope that external events somehow change things.
Trump seems to be more and more like one of those general managers in baseball who trades all the prospects to try to win the World Series next year. And when people say, well, what's this going to mean for the team in 5 years? In 5 years, I'm going to be on the beach.
But having won in 2016, so I would just, that's a very good analogy. As a baseball fan, I kind of like that analogy. But the difference would be that he did that. They all said you can't win.
He won,
or he almost won. Let's say he won the league championship.
Right.
And a couple of these old veterans are a little better than you expected.
Yeah.
And they got lucky with one young guy or something. You know what I mean? And so the people think, yeah, we can do another year or two of this.
We can keep
and,
doing
you know,
it.
Who knows what the future brings?
But the big issue there will be, is there a way to undo the image that Trump has imprinted among younger generations? Or has he stamped the Republican Party as a party of racial and cultural intolerance for essentially the millennial and the post-millennial generation? You know, the cohort theory versus the life cycle theory about whether politics change when they age somewhat, but the dominant impact is when they come of age politically. And if you're talking about, you know, 70% of people 18 to 29 saying they disapprove of Trump, and 65% saying they think he's a racist, and 65% saying, 70% saying he doesn't respect women. Okay, does that go away in 2022 or 2024 if he's not there? Or is the Republican Party, I mean, are they essentially signaling that, as I said, everybody got the joke. Everybody who was the target of Trump's veiled and not so veiled symbolism and imagery recognized that he was essentially questioning whether they belonged here. And they came out to say pretty affirmatively, I do belong here. And I think they will probably show up in even bigger numbers in 2020, although his side will as well. And that's why it's just like Battle of the Bulge. That's where we're headed.
Okay, on that note, we'll get together in a year, maybe just before 2020, the actual primaries begin. Mm. We'll discover all kinds of strange things have happened in 2019, and the whole deck has been shuffled or not. I mean, the big story of the preceding 2 years really is the deck didn't get reshuffled.
No,
right?
It just moved further.
It was more of the same, but 2018 looks like 2016.
A little more with the college whites moving further.
Right.
Moving further away, because you don't have Clinton. You didn't have the ballast of Clinton holding them back. And this may have been what white-collar white America thought of Trump all the way through, and when you didn't have Clinton.
Right.
But yeah.
And when you could cast the vote for the House member, which was going to check Trump, but you weren't quite voting for some other Democrat. So the question is, how much easier is it to be the Democratic candidate against Trump as opposed to the Democratic candidate for a House seat?
Harder.
Just are going to be one of many checking Trump. No one really worries in Northern Virginia that whoever the Democrat we elected was is going to pass whatever legislation she claimed to be for.
Harder in every respect except one, which is that the one exception is that very difficult for a House candidate to turn out young people.
Yeah, so that's the...
That'd be the one exception, that the young people where Trump is really cratering and the Republican Party is really, as I said way back when, they lost 18-29 in every state with an exit poll.
Yeah.
Everyone, except for Indiana where they tied. So that includes North Dakota and Missouri and Texas and Arizona. And they lost them by big margins almost everywhere. And I guarantee you in 2020, there will be a higher share of the electorate than they were in 2018.
Okay, well, that guarantee. It's good to be left with some guarantee as opposed to total.
Exactly.
No, this was terrific, Ron. So thank you
very
much.
Thanks for having me.
Being here. And thank you for joining us on Conversations.